Study Spectrum in Rohit sir ki class. Today we are going to discuss about a water, a natural resource. Earlier we had already discussed about all the natural resources, which were those: air, soil, water, mineral oils, animals and plants. Which is the biggest natural resource out of all this? Yes, you are correct, it's water. Of all the natural resources we have which help us in our living, who give us all the needed things required for our living to meet all our requirements, of all these natural resources, water is the biggest resource we have on our earth. And still we have to think about how to conserve the water. Why so? The same thing we are going to discuss in today's discussion: water, a natural resource. First, let's start with the basic discussion: why water is important in our life. As all we know that all the living organisms need water for the living, right? Without water, we cannot survive. For plants, water is essential. Without water, they cannot grow at all. All the animals, they need water. Without water, they also cannot survive. They will not get their food because plants will not grow. These are the very broad spectrum views. Let's think in our day-to-day life, why we need water. The moment we wake up in the morning, starting from that to the moment we go to the bed at night. Just go through our day-to-day schedule and think, where do we need the water? Almost at every step, right? When we wake up, we need water for the cleaning, then we need water for cooking, we prepare our food with the help of water. Then throughout the day, wherever we go, water is a very essential part of each and every activity. Even whatever growth we have done, whatever industrialization is there, whatever the science has done, the progress, each and every aspect of human civilization, it dependent on the water. Without water, no industry can run. Without water, no factories can run. So ultimately, water is the most essential aspect of our day-to-day life, as well as a human or an animal or a living world on this earth. Water is most important natural resource. And yes, of course, it is the biggest resource we have on this earth. How? We all know that almost of all the surface of earth, 71% of earth's surface is covered with the water. Those we are called as oceans. Most of the water is there in the oceans. So 71% of the earth's surface is covered with the water. We call them oceans, right? So there is a huge abundant water over there. But can we use that water? I'm talking about the water in seas or the oceans. No, that water is a salty water. We cannot use that water for the drinking or maybe for our food. No, not at all. Even if we try to use that water for our industries, machines won't work, because percentage of the salts in that water is way higher than what we require in our regular processes. So can you imagine this much, such an abundant water resource, and how much we humans are left with? Not only humans, but all the plants, all the animals, all the living organisms on this earth are left with very few percentage of the water. How many percentage? Out of all the water resources we have on the earth, 97% water is in the oceans. So that is a salt water, that is out of question. We cannot utilize that water in our day-to-day life. That water cannot support living on the land. So remaining is the 3%. Wait, not even that 3% is of our use. Out of that 3%, 2.7% water is in the form of ice on the polar region of the earth. or maybe in the underground, percolated deep down in the soil. So how many percentage we are left with? Just 0.3% of all the water resource we have on the earth. Just 0.3% of that we have for our living. That water, 0.3%, is in the form of lakes, ponds, rivers, which we call a sweet water, which we utilize for our regular living. So, water, even being a biggest natural resource on this earth, actually a usable water is so much less. And that's why there is always a crisis of water scarcity throughout the world. Yes, indeed, it's a crisis. And we always have to think about how to utilize that 0.3% water more efficiently, that there will be abundant water for the living on the earth. Which are the sources of this water? Whenever, henceforth, in this discussion, whenever we will talk about a water, a usable water, always remember we are talking about that remaining 0.3% water, not the 99.7% water, which is in the form of salty water in oceans, or maybe in the form of ice at the polar region, or maybe the underground waters. No. Wherever we are talking about the water, we are talking about that remaining 0.3% water, which is left for our living. So which are the sources of this water? We can say a sweet water, which we can use for our day-to-day life. Rivers, streams, ponds, lakes, dams, water reservoirs, all these are the sources of sweet water. Also, wells and tube wells, those are also sources. How do they function? How do we get the water from wells? We dig down, right? And we dig down, deep down in the soil, and we get water underground. How do the water resources formed underground? Have you ever thought about it? How water goes deep down there in the soil? Yes, of course. While flowing through the rivers, or maybe in the ponds or dams, reservoirs, this water sinks down the soil. It percolates downstairs, and automatically, whichever ways the water founds inside, between the rocks or sand, it flows and it comes to the one point, and then there is a underground water source formed. And through wells and tube wells, we utilize that water for our use. That is what we call it as a groundwater. But nowadays, we are using those groundwater levels are falling down because of consistent use of groundwater. But these are the sources of the water. 5% water, we are talking about the water which is fit for the drinking. The drinking water sources, the sweet water sources. Sea has most of the water which is salty water which we cannot use. So remaining are the sources for drinking water or water we can use for our day-to-day life. Those sources are wells, tube wells which utilizes the groundwater, and streams, rivers, ponds, lakes. These are the water sources on the surface of the earth. And these are the sources which are replenished by rainwater, of course. So you can imagine now, day by day, natural calamities, nature is changing day by day. There is not enough rain in most of the part in the world. Even if we talk about India, in Maharashtra, we know every now and then there is a way less rain and there is dry land. There is not even enough water for kettles, so they die. So rainwater is only source for replenishing our 0.3% usable water resources. And rain is depleting day by day because of cutting of the forest. So all these natural resources are actually interconnected, what we call as a natural cycle of the water. But that is disturbed due to increase in population, increase in industrialization, cutting down the forest, trees. We have already discussed in our earlier chapter, natural resources, right? Let's move ahead with the discussion of this 0.3% water. We have seen what are the sources where we get our usable water from, but in which forms on the earth we have abundant water, but we get it in different forms. Which are those? Very first, we see water in seas or river, ponds, lakes. We see it in a liquid form, a flowing water, right? That is a liquid form we get. Another form is there. I already told you, 2.7% of all the water resource is stored in the form of ice on the polar region or maybe on the top of high mountains. See the Himalayas, Kulu, Manali, people go there for tourism and they want to see that snowfall and ice-ladded all the mountains. But that ice consists of that 2.7% of water resource. So there is another form, a solid form of water. We found this water on the earth. And the third form, obviously a gaseous state, we call it as a water vapor. We get water on this earth in the form of water vapors. In the air, in atmosphere, when there is more water vapors in the air, we call it as a humid air. Most of the time in rainy season and throughout the year nearby coastal region, there is always a humid air, right? We get very much sweaty at that time. That humid air, because of there is a more content of water vapors in the atmosphere. So these are the forms. Let's talk about this water vapors. This is most important phenomenon of the nature. Why I'm talking like this? I'll give you an example. Very first, let's discuss about how water changes its forms. Now we all know how ice is formed. In our day-to-day life, we see ice cubes in the freezer, right? There is a lower temperature than 0 degree. So 0 degree Celsius is a melting point for water. Below 0 degree, water transforms itself into the solid state. We call it as a ice. At 0 degree, it melts and it's converted into its liquid state, flowing water. And 100 degree Celsius is a boiling point for water. So at 100 degree Celsius, water starts converting into its gaseous states, water vapors. But you know, what is the most beautiful part of this water vapor conversion from its liquid state to gaseous state? That phenomenon is called as evaporation. Just imagine if there is a small water droplets or water is spilled over the floor. We need to wipe it up. but we forget it. After a few hours, when we come back, is that water spilled on the floor still there? No, it's vanished. Where does it go? It has evaporated. When there are wet clothes hang on the strings, after some time, obviously, temperature has not exceeded to 100 degrees Celsius. If temperature goes to 100 degrees Celsius, we cannot survive. In summer season, when temperature goes beyond 40 degrees Celsius, then also we have sensed already, right? How much trouble we get. So, temperature cannot go automatically to 100 degrees Celsius in the nature. Then how come those wet clothes get dried after some time automatically? Have you ever thought about it? Evaporation, friends. Water gets evaporated from 0 degree to 100 degree any temperature. Doesn't matter what the temperature is, only the higher the temperature, evaporation rate is faster. That is the only case. But even at 4 degree, 5 degree, 6 degree, 7 degree, 10 degrees chilling temperature, water gets evaporated. Water automatically transforms itself to the gaseous state. And this evaporation is the most beautiful and important phenomenon of the nature. Because of that, we are all living. How? Just think about why I said this. Listen again. Evaporation is most important and a beautiful phenomenon of the nature. Because of that, we are living. Do you know how rain is formed? Rain is there through the clouds. What are the clouds? Clouds are the water vapors. Water vapors will go through the cool air and automatically it condenses itself and forms water vapors to droplets, and due to the gravity, those water droplets fall down on the earth. We call it as a rain. And due to the rain, we all are living. You all know that. Whatever 0.3% sweet water we get it from the rain only. But where does that rain comes from? That rain comes from clouds. Where does those clouds come from? Yes, of course. Cloud is formed by the evaporated water vapors from the sea, from the ocean. See, in the ocean there is whole salt water, correct? We cannot use that salty water. That 97%, a huge amount, we cannot use that. But nature has made such a beautiful arrangement for all of us that every now and then, earth climate cannot exceed to 100%, right? So automatically water will boil, it will form the vapors, then from those vapors it will condense and we will get the sweet water. No, if temperature goes to 100 degrees Celsius, no living organism can survive on the earth. But water can evaporate at any temperature ranging from 0 degree to 100 degree. That is called water evaporation, and that's the most beautiful phenomenon, because throughout the year, water surface of the oceans, water keeps on evaporating. It forms a gaseous state of water, and those water vapors are obviously lighter, so they goes up in the air and those accumulate over there and makes the cloud. Due to the winds, those clouds are carried on to the land, and while on the land, they get obstructed due to the high mountains or the trees, and there they get the cooler air and this starts condensing and automatically rain is formed. So by natural law, due to this phenomenon of evaporation of water, a salt water is evaporated. But while evaporating, only waters, H2O, only pure water is evaporated, not the salts along with that. Correct? So automatically the salt water is converted to the sweet water due to the natural process of evaporation, and we get our 0.3% usable water, and on that water, whole living world on this earth is surviving. That's why I called evaporation is most important and beautiful phenomenon of the nature. It's nature's arrangement for all of us. And that is the natural cycle of the water. Ultimately, whatever the rainwater we have, it flows down again to the sea, right? because rain starts on the mountains, it's converted into streams, all these streams come together to form rivers. All those rivers flow down and meet somewhere to the sea again. So whatever water is evaporated by nature itself is formed into the rain, a sweet water, and that sweet water again flows down to the nature. So nature has already made an arrangement that every year I'll put some amount to your bank account of your water. This is the bank account of, let's consider an example of, we have a bank account. Every day morning there will be a deposition from the God or a nature, we can say. The only condition is whatever God or nature deposits to that bank account, we have to utilize it till again tomorrow morning. Tomorrow morning there will be another deposition, but whatever is left from earlier, it will be swiped away. It will be of no use for our tomorrow. What would you do if you have such a magical bank account? No need to work, right? No need to worry. Every day we are going to get something in our bank account which will help us to survive. So no need to work. We would just celebrate. We would just celebrate our living. We have such account, friends. Nature has created such account for us. That account is of water. Every year, nature, through its own phenomenon of evaporation and its own arrangement, gives us the sweet water through rains. But the only condition of that, every year we'll get the rain, but whatever we get from that rain, we have to utilize it wisely. If we can make the maximum use of that, there is abundant water. No need to think about the water conservation. There is abundant water through rains, but we are not able to utilize that water properly. What happens with the rainwater is, that rainwater is again flown down to the sea. So all the salt, fresh, sweet water through the rain, once it meets the sea, it again becomes the salty water. It has of no use to our living thing. So what we need to do is, we need to learn how to use water properly. We need to make that water stay. We need to make that water percolate deep down the ground so that groundwater level increases, as well as we need to divert these rainwaters to the distant places where there is no rain through canals, what we call as a irrigation. So all this discussion we are going to do, but this was all about the forms of the water. There are three forms of the water. One is ice, a solid state, liquid, and gaseous state, that is what we call as a water vapor. And evaporation is most beautiful and important phenomenon of the nature, because of which we get our 0.3% remaining usable water resource. And through this evaporation, water always converts itself to its gaseous state. It is done at any temperature ranging from 0 degree to 100 degree Celsius. Higher the temperature, faster the evaporation. Good. notice how evaporation is the most important phenomenon. But at the same time, evaporation becomes a biggest problem also. Because nature will not think about whether it's evaporating the salt water from the sea or it's evaporating the sweet water on the earth's surface, right? It will evaporate all the water content it has. So, what happens is, due to the evaporation phenomenon, we get our rains, and whatever water resource we get, that water is flowing on the surface of the earth freely. And while that, even if we make the canals, through the canals from the river, water is rediverted to the places where there is a very less rain, which is we call as a irrigation. But while transporting this water, or maybe we have stored our water into the ponds or lakes, which are naturally formed due to the rainwater, but that water is also evaporated and water content goes down. So while utilizing, what I told you was, we have such bank account, the only issue is we need to learn how to utilize that bank account very wisely. Every year we have rain and we have plenty of water, but either it is flown down to the seas again of no use, or it gets evaporated and water content is depleted again. How to stop this evaporation of a sweet water which is usable for us? There are few ideas through which we can stop evaporation of our usable water content. One, when there is a huge water content stored in, let's say, lakes or ponds, there automatically water surface is always evaporating. To stop that evaporation, what is done is, there is a alcohol called as cetyl alcohol. Cetyl alcohol is lighter than water, so it is sprayed all over the surface of that lake. It makes a thin layer over the surface of the lake, and then it automatically prevents the evaporation of water surface. That is one way we can stop evaporation of our usable water sources from huge water resource, what we call as a ponds or lakes or water reservoirs, through the dams on the rivers we have created, whatever. But on the surface of the water, once we spread the cetyl alcohol, it forms a thin layer and it prevents the water evaporation to much extent. That is the one way we can stop evaporation. Second, while the irrigation, what we have is canals, and canals are the open ducts actually. Water is transformed from this place to very far distant place where there is very less rain. This transportation of the water in between, there is huge loss of this water content due to the evaporation. How can we stop it? Of course, pipeline. If that water is flown through the pipeline, automatically evaporation is almost zero and we can conserve our usable water sources. Obviously, pipeline is quite costly than regular canals, but that cost is worth. Another thing, most of the time, why do we need this water? We need it for agriculture, for the forest, for trees to grow, because it will create a positive natural cycle for us. So we use this water for food creation in the farms or maybe for the forests, which in turn will help more rain fall, correct? So what happens is, obviously you all know that all the plants, they have roots deep down in the soil. Those roots absorb the water content of groundwater. But due to the temperature, what happens is, even the water in the soil, water content or moist soil, it gets dried up. Why? Water from even deep down the ground, that also evaporates due to the temperature. And land becomes dry. There is very less water left for the roots of the plants to absorb and to grow. So what is done actually is, when we are planting a trees while farming, we plant them and grow them under the plastic seeds. What that plastic seed does? Obviously, the water content of the ground in the soil, it evaporates. But as in water vapors go up in the air, those are obstructed due to that plastic sheet, and it again condenses and falls down on the earth. So the groundwater level is maintained and there is a proper growth of the crop or the plants or the forest, whatever we are planning for. So these are the few ideas through which we can stop water evaporation and we can conserve our usable water resource, which we get from the nature as its natural arrangement, natural water cycle through the beautiful phenomenon of evaporation. We get that water because of evaporation, and now we are trying to stop that evaporation of whatever we are left with. What an irony, but it's a beautiful phenomenon. Let's move ahead. While talking about evaporation of water, the most important part we need to think about is why seawater is salty and why rainwater is not salty, why it is sweet. Obviously, the water in the oceans have high density of salts dissolved in it, so it is very salty. But the beautiful part of evaporation is it evaporates only water and not its content. So whenever water evaporates, water vapors are always 101% purified water. That's why when those gaseous state water vapors form the cloud, and then that cloud again condenses and forms the water droplets, those water droplets doesn't have at all any salt in it. So automatically it's the purest form of the water. And this is the phenomenon how we can understand how we make a salt at salt pans near seashore. Have you ever seen those salt pans? How the salt is made? There are the salt pans made near the seashores. In the high tide, water obviously comes to the salt pans. While low tide, when water goes back, those salt pan has retained its own water content. It doesn't again go back, right? Because those are the shallow or deep salt pans. So water is retained over there. Automatically, due to the natural process of evaporation, all the water is evaporated, leaving back all the salts and mineral content of it. So the water which is actually has all the salts in it dissolved form, when it evaporates, the pure water forms is taken out. What is left out is all the dissolved crystals of all the salts and minerals. Then that accumulated salts and minerals are taken up, they are purified, and the salt is made. So this is how we get our salt, the most important ingredient in our food, that is also made due to the natural phenomenon of evaporation. See, I told you, evaporation is the most important and beautiful phenomenon of the nature for the human or animal life, we can say. Because due to the evaporation, we get rain every year, we get purified water, nature gives it that. And also, we get salt. Without salt, can you ever imagine having your food? No, we cannot. That salt also is formed due to the natural phenomenon of the evaporation. So, all the forms of the water we have discussed, but why we need to think about water conservation? Because whatever we are left with, whatever 0.3% water content we have with us, it's getting polluted day by day. It is of no use of us if it is polluted, if it is contaminated. We have already left with very small content of water resource what we have on this earth, and if even if that resource get contaminated, if even that resource get polluted, then we are in a big problem. So we need to think about this water pollution. First, let's discuss what is water pollution at first place. any wastewater, any contaminated, harmful, hazardous chemicals from industries, or maybe our toilet water, urinals, all the effluent, all the wastewater, when it is let go in the rivers, in the fresh water is contaminated with all those harmful, hazardous chemicals, wastewater, we don't know, whatever has dissolved in that water. So automatically, water contains all the contaminated germs, floating particles, and whatnot. So this is what we call as a water pollution. And our water sources are getting polluted day by day because of all these things.